Well, amen. Are you glad to be in God's house tonight?
Amen.
Feeling good just to get to come. Worship.
Yes.
Pray. Vent sometimes, you know. Isn't it good when you do that, see, with family?
Amen.
Amen. We don't fall on a bunch of pretense around here and all of that stuff. Formality, I hope. I'm not the least formal guy you've ever met.
Amen.
You picked the wrong cat, right? If that's your thing. But, amen, I had the opportunity this week when I was visiting with and just offering ministry for the Lively family to meet a young man. And I met this young man and had an opportunity to talk with him a little bit. And he said to me, he's, I don't know, 23 or 4 years old, I guess. And he said to me, he said, well, yeah, I believe in Jesus. He said, I mean, I've been baptized and I've been saved. But he said, I got some problems with it. I said, well, amen. He said, me and him just aren't on speaking terms right now. And I said, well, okay, amen. How would you like to get back on speaking terms? But listen, you need to hear him. He doesn't have to hear from you. He wants to, but he doesn't have to. It's imperative that you hear from him. And so I was able to take my Bible, my little witnessing Bible, share with him some things from God's Word. I don't know that I got anywhere, but I gave him the Word. The Word does the work. I don't. The Word does.
Amen.
And so hopefully that be praying prayer for him that God will work on in his heart.
Amen.
He believes that he's saved, but there's absolutely no fruit of salvation. None in his life. As a matter of fact, he's living his life in absolute contradiction to the Word of God. And so it gives you cause for pause. You see, when someone shares, now I don't judge people. That's not my job. I'm not qualified and I don't have the authority to do it. But God has instructed us to have good judgment and to judge the mud. Like we said last week or Sunday night. You know, when the little boy who gets dirty outside playing and the daddy says you can't come in the house like that, covered in that mud, and he takes him over and hoses him off out in the yard so he can come in the house. Mm-hmm. And it's not the little boy that he's rejecting, it's the mud.
That's right.
You see, and that's what God rejects.
Amen.
And that's what we are to reject.
Amen.
We're to reject the mud.
Amen.
Not the person.
Amen.
But the mud. And but there's coming a time when God is going to judge.
It's true.
Because he will have to. Not because he wants to. Because he will have to. He is long-suffering. The Bible says he would that none would perish, but that all would come to repentance. So those that will receive the judgments of God are doing it against God's will. They're receiving that against the will of God. He doesn't want to judge, but he will. Because if he didn't, he would cease to be holy. And he would not be God. And so he cannot violate who he is, you see. He must be God. But he's given us warning after warning after warning. Yes, Lord, after warning. Amen.
Good morning.
Amen. If you look in 2 Thessalonians with me, we were in 1 Thessalonians Sunday night. I want to dig a little deeper in the well. We're going to move over to 2 Thessalonians tonight for just a few minutes in chapter 2. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. When you get there, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Now we beginning in verse number 1. Now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and by our gathering together unto him, that ye be not soon shaken in mind, or be troubled, neither by spirit, nor by word, nor by letter, as from us, as that the day of Christ is at hand. Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come, except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition, who opposeth and exalteth himself above all that is called God, or that is worshipped, so that he as God sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is. Remember ye not that when I was yet with you, I told you these things? And now ye know what withholdeth, that he might be revealed in his time. For the mystery of iniquity doth already work. Only he who now letteth will let, until he be taken out of the way. Mm-hmm. And then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming. Even him who is coming is after the working of Satan, with all power and signs and lying wonders, and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they receive not the love of the truth, that they might be saved. And for this cause God shall send them strong delusion. And for this cause God shall send them strong delusion, that they should believe a lie, that they all might be damned, and who believe not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. Father God, we thank you for your word. We ask now, Father, you bless the reading of it. Help us to glean the things that you have for us tonight, and we'll give you the praise and the honor and the glory for it all, for only you are worthy. In Jesus' name and for his sake, we ask and pray. Amen. Jesus is coming. The King is coming. Again, now we talked about that Sunday night. We talked about the authority of which I can make that declaration on the authority of God's word and on the authority of the words of Christ Jesus himself. He is coming. Remember, John chapter 14. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. Amen. I'm going to prepare a place for you now. And if I go to prepare a place, if I'm going to all that trouble, I'm going to come again and receive you unto myself. And where I am, there you may be also. The one first reason that he is coming back is to draw his people to him. He's going to take his bride out of this world.
Right.
Because wrath, the wrath of God, such as this world has never seen before, will take place after the calling away of his bride, after the rapture of the church. Grace is gone. Grace is gone. And so he does not want his bride to have to endure. I wouldn't want my bride to have to endure any hardship or anything like that. Would you? Of course not. None of us here would. And Jesus doesn't want his bride to have to endure these things. I've heard messages preached on that where they believe that the church is going to go through the tribulation. I can't get there in God's word. I've tried. I've tried to take their perspective and their point of view and understand it and study it out and get there by the writings of God's word. I can't get there, Brother Doug. from what the Bible teaches me. Paul says it here. He said, listen, these things aren't going to happen until some other things happen first. He said there's going to be a falling away. Now, this is during the tribulation period, is what Paul is talking about here. There's going to be a falling away, and there's going to be great delusion so that people will believe a lie rather than to believe the truth. So anyone who makes a statement like, well, if the rapture happens, then I'm going to have some answers, some questions for God. No, you're not. Because he's going to have some questions for you in 1,007 years. If the there will be those that are saved during the rapture, I mean during the tribulation period. There will be those who come to know God and trust God during the tribulation period. They're going to lose their life. But they are going to endure some horrific, horrific things because of their faith. But there will be those that will be saved during the tribulation period. But there will come a point about 3.5 years into this tribulation period when all of that is going to be over. All of that is going to cease. God is going to send delusion so that all that have taken the mark of the beast, because by then the only people that are alive on this earth are going to have the mark of the beast. If they don't have it, they'll be killed. Period. You get that? If they don't, those that don't take, if they take the mark, they have sealed their eternal destiny at that moment. Because the mark of the beast is a loyalty to Satan. That is a loyalty oath to Satan. That's how God views that. And so that's it. And he will send delusion that you wouldn't believe the truth if it stood in front of it. Jesus himself could come and stand in front of them, show them the nail prints in his hands, show them the nail scars in his feet, show them the scars from the thorns, show them the hole in his side, and they'll never believe it. Because God won't allow it. That to me is one of the most heartbreaking things of the entire tribulation period. Those that will seal their own destiny, their own eternity, in a lake of fire for bread. They will sell their soul for bread, and we're offering them a father who owns the bakery.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's right.
And they cannot grasp it. They cannot get a hold of it. There will be a falling away. I believe that's happening now, by the way. I believe that with all of my heart.
Amen.
I believe, and I'm not one to set dates or none of those kind of crazy things. I just read the Word of God and I make it my own mind. But I believe we're close, folks. I believe we are very, very close. And I know you've heard that all of your life. You know. But I'm 54 years old. What's 54 years to God? It's an eye. You know, it's a blink of an eye. Most scientists say that the world began with a big bang. I'm going to tell you, I don't know if it did or not. God said, let there be. Boom, there was. I don't know if there was an actual bang or not. But I know this one. He said, let there be light. There was life. Immediately, there was life. Amen. But I'm going to tell you this. It's going to end with a bang.
Yeah.
A big bang. Mm-hmm. Amen. When the president enters a room, there's great fanfare, and everybody stands to their feet, and everybody cheers and claps, and they play the You know, the trumpets play, all of that and everything. I want you to know, when Jesus steps out onto that cloud, amen, there's going to be a fanfare like this world has never heard before. Mm-hmm. I mean, the trumpet is going to blast.
Right.
The archangel is going to shout. And Jesus ain't going to say a word. He's going to step out on the cloud in power and great glory.
That's right.
And those who are eagerly looking and longing and wanting to see him are going to see him. Those who are not going to see him.
Right.
Bible is explicitly clear on that. That's why they're going to say, well, I don't know what happened to all them millions of people. I guess the aliens got them. You know, or they're going to be on Fox News and CNN and NBC and all that, and they're going to be sitting around these tables. All these smart people are going to be sitting around these tables trying to explain why all these graves are busted open.
Right.
Doug, exactly. And they don't have a clue.
Yeah,
why are all of these tombs busted open and the people that were in them gone? What's going on? Where were all of those people that were in these airplanes and automobiles and trains and ships? And they're just gone. In a nanosecond, boom, they're gone. I watched that movie, I think I told you before. I can't remember the name of it now, but,
Left Behind.
Yeah, that's it, Left Behind. And that fellow's flying that airplane, man, and it just, boom. It's like he hit a little turbulence and everybody, you know, half the plane was gone.
Right.
Nothing there but their belongings. Amen. You're not going to heaven with anything but Jesus.
Right.
Amen.
Amen.
Not anything. So what is it we're working so hard for? Amen. Are we working hard for him? Or are we working hard for, amen, the thing that most people trust in? 1 Thessalonians 4:16, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Man, you talk about something to see. You're coming. All in grave, Mike. Boom. Busted open. Then those we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. That's us, the believers who are alive. Or remain. That's called the rapture. We call that the rapture. And we talked about that Sunday night. The word's not in the Bible. I understand that. But what it means is in there. Caught away. Amen. We'll join them at the marriage supper of the Lamb in the heavens after the tribulation period. He will return to the earth to rule and to reign. When Christ calls his bride away, he won't step a foot or a toe on this earth. He'll be in the clouds of glory. Amen. But at the end of exactly 7 years from that rapture, he is going to come back to earth, Brother Michael. And I'm going to tell you something. He ain't coming as a carpenter. Amen. He ain't coming as a preacher. Amen. He's not a doctor or a great prophet or anything. He is coming as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And the Bible says he shall rule this earth with a rod of iron. And of his kingdom there shall be no end.
Right.
That's the God we serve. That's who we're going to meet in the air.
Amen.
That's going to happen. Absolutely, without a doubt. That's going to happen. I don't believe that, brother. Ain't going to amen. Be wrong if you want to. You will in a little while. He'll return to this earth to take vengeance on those who do not know God and his redemption. Look in verse number 8 of 2 Thessalonians 1, just a little bit back up there. Verse 8, chapter 1. In flaming fire, taking vengeance on them that know not God and that obey not the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Christ, who shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his power. It's not going to be a happy time for those who are left behind. It's not going to be, I'm going to demand anything from God. God is going to be demanding some things from us, from them who are left behind. Amen.
Amen.
It will have begun. It's sad to think about the terrible end of those not ready to meet God. And this is my message to this church tonight. God help us. God help us to get the message of the gospel to those who are lost and dying. You don't want what's coming to happen to your worst enemy. Not your worst enemy. He's also coming back to destroy the Antichrist. When Christ returns, he will destroy the Antichrist at the end of those 7 years, and he'll do it with the brightness of his glory. Amen. And with the sword of his word. Amen. The prince of darkness will be crushed, amen, by the bright and morning star. Glory. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. Glory. Hallelujah. That all the destruction that he will impose before then, and God is going to use him as an instrument. You understand that, right? He is never, ever going to be in control. God is going to be in control of the entire deal. All he is will be a pawn in God's sword of wrath. But in Revelation 19:20, it says, and the beast was taken, and with him the false prophet that wrought miracles before him, with which he deceived them that had received the mark of the beast, and he destroys them. Amen. And them that worshiped him. This is not a fun message, I'm just going to tell you. Amen. In Revelation chapter 16, let's turn over. This is why we must be about the Father's business. Revelation chapter 16. These are God's seven final judgments on the world. On those who have rejected him. And this is not easy to take, but it's the truth. Beginning verse number 1, and I heard a great voice out of the temple saying to the seven angels, go your ways and pour out the vials of the wrath of God upon the earth. And the first went and poured out his vial upon the earth, and there fell a noisome and grievous sore upon the men which had the mark of the beast, and upon them which worshipped his image. I don't know what this sore is, but it's going to be like boils, I believe, and only on steroids. Almost like nuclear fallout. I don't know if you've ever seen any images of what happens to people who have radiation poisoning. The sores and the things that come up on them. It'll be worse than Job. Worse than that. Something sort of like leprosy. Maybe not leprosy. Maybe a sore that's, like I said, nuclear fallout in nature or something. But it's poured out upon the worshipers of the Antichrist. Since they bear the mark of the beast, they're going to be easy to locate. If you didn't know what the Bible says, you'd be all for this mark, by the way. They're going to want this mark. They're going to think that's the greatest thing that anybody ever came up with. No more checks, no more credit cards, no nothing. You just scan it and you're good to go. You know. Those left on earth will have that mark, but it's not just the government that's going to be looking for them. It's this first angel of God. Who's going to be seeking out those who have remarked, germ warfare happens in a way that it's never been for. No kind of weapons of mass destruction are, they'll pale in comparison to this first bowl of wrath. Secondly, look in verse 3. It says, and the second angel poured out his vial upon the sea, and it became as the blood of a dead man. And every living soul died in the sea. All life in all of the oceans, in all of the world, will die. All of it. All of the salt water is affected, and every single soul in it dies. Earlier in the tribulation period, and I won't turn it now, but one third of the waters were affected. But that was just a warning. That was just a sample of what was to come. This is much, much worse. Think of the beaches of the world that you love to go to. Lay out the sun, play in the water, and all of those things. Covered in carcasses of dead sea life. Whatever's in there, and there's stuff in there, we don't even know. It will all be dead. It will all be washed up on the shore all over the world. Can you imagine the stench of that? I mean, just to try to breathe will gag you. They've got the sores. They've got no relief. They've got constant nausea since the waters are contaminated. Ocean-going vessels will come to a halt. And the world now doesn't realize how dependent we are upon God. Now the salt waters of the world are God's cleansing agent for the filth of man. They dump everything out there. But on that day, no longer. He's going to give it all back. My. In verses number 4. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color, and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand, full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication. And upon her forehead was a name written, Mystery, Babylon, the great, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. And I saw the woman drunken with the blood of the saints, and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. And when I saw her, I wondered with great admiration. And the angel said unto me, Wherefore didst thou marvel? I will tell thee the mystery of the woman, and the beast that carrieth her, which hath the 7 heads and 10 horns. Amen. I got in the wrong book. I'm sorry. I got ahead of myself. Amen. I mean, back again. Glory to God. And the third angel poured out his vial upon the rivers and fountains of waters, and they became blood. This was the attack, the salt water, and now the fresh water. All poisoned and affected. Fresh water is the target. The only resource left now is being plagued. Jesus turned water into wine, his very first miracle. But now the Father turns it into blood. The angel says to the Lord, there's a poetic justice in what you've done. The Antichrist has shed much blood of those who refused to mark, and many through the ages before then, and now they reap what they have sown. Be not deceived. Galatians chapter 6 and verse 7. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. Whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. Pharaoh declared male Jewish babies would be drowned, and that is how he and his entire army died, remember? Amen. Esther, in the book of Esther, Haman decided to exterminate the Jews, and he wanted to start by hanging Mordecai. And he concocted his plan and started to put it into motion. How did that plan end? Do you remember the story? Do you remember the story? He was discovered and hung on the very gallows that he prepared for Mordecai. God is not mocked. Amen. Who is under the altar? Who is under the altar of God? Amen. Martyrs, and they're crying out, how long? How long? How long will you wait to judge them? And here they say, God, good job. Thank you, Father, you have avenged us. The fourth bowl, verse number 8. And the fourth angel poured out his vial upon the sun, and the power was given unto him to scorch men with fire. The greatest heat wave in history will occur. Real global warming, not some mythical thing out there. This will be the real thing. It will be heat so unbearable that bodies will be scorched, and it's a foretaste of hell, I believe, right here on earth, with very little water to drink. Keep that in mind. The salt waters have been destroyed. The rivers have been destroyed. All of those things, heat exhaustion, skin cancer, many will die of thirst. They will be scorched. It's kind of ironic when Jesus was dying on the cross, the sun refused to shine, to illuminate. That same sun is going to burn with a fury like never before. The Old Testament prophets prophesied this plague, Deuteronomy 13, 24. They shall be burnt with hunger and devoured with burning heat and with bitter destruction. Isaiah 24 and 6. Therefore hath the curse devoured the earth, and they that dwell therein are desolate. Therefore the inhabitants of the earth are burned, and few men left. Few. Fact is, no one would be left if God did not supernaturally shorten the days. Even in his wrath, he is giving mercy. Even in his wrath. The Bible says that he will shorten his days. At Matthew 24 and 22, Jesus said, and except those days should be shortened, there should be no flesh saved. Some people think that that means the tribulation will be shortened. No, 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 no. Seven is God's perfection. It will be 7 years, but the actual days will be shortened so that some will be able to survive. Malachi 4 and 1 says, for behold, the day cometh that shall burn as an oven, and all the proud, yea, all that do wickedly shall be stubble, and the day that cometh shall burn them up, saith the Lord of hosts. You have prophets over 3,000 years prophesying this exact same thing. My, how could anyone doubt that? Anyone? Think about this. We're already seeing nature and science struggling to explain things that are going on in nature. Great earthquakes shall be in diverse places, and famines and pestilence and fearful sights, and great signs shall there be from heaven. And there shall be signs in the sun and in the moon and in the stars and upon the earth, distress of nations with perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring, men's hearts failing them for fear and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth. For the power of heaven shall be shaken Luke chapter 21. Signs in the heavens means the realms of nature. Can you see the signs of the times anywhere today? All God would have to do to create this scenario is to remove one layer of the atmospheric blanket that he currently has laid over the earth to protect us. One layer. Just a sheet. Keep the comforter. Just take the sheet off. We'll burn it up. We'll burn it up. Solar flares. You'd think that would break me. You would think that that would be the thing to do it, you know. Hey, I work in this heat. I know. It break me. That's why I know I can't go through the tribulation, man. I have to work in this summer in this mess. Amen. Don't ever think that judgment brings men to repentance, because it doesn't. It rarely, if ever, does. The love of God brings men to repentance. Those in hell aren't begging to be saved. They curse, they blaspheme God, they gnash their teeth and snarl their face at God. And once you die, your character is fixed forever. How do you know? Because in Revelation chapter 22, verse 11, he that is unjust, let him be unjust still. And he which is filthy, let him be filthy still. And he that is righteous, let him be righteous still. And he that is holy, let him be holy still. He's talking about eternity. The unsaved continues to sin in hell, rebel all he can, and his hatred toward his judge continues forever and torments him forever. There's a description of hell in verse 9. And men were scorched with great heat and blasphemed the name of God which hath power over these plagues, and they repented not to give him glory. They won't repent. They won't, even the one who can remove all of these things. Let me give you real quickly four words to describe the judgment of God. Number one, he's unwilling. Unwilling. The Lord is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. If you're left behind after the rapture to suffer these horrible judgments, it will be absolutely against the will of God. Mm-hmm. 2 Peter 3. Is never, ever quickly judged. He's always long-suffering, allows us time to choose. He does not want a bunch of robot slaves forced to serve him. He wants us to choose to serve him, to love him, to surrender unto him. He wants volunteers. He wants you to love him because he loves you. You see. Noah, 120 years he preached before judgment fell. 120 years he told them exactly what was going to happen. Sodom and Gomorrah, for years God's people wondered why God had allowed it to continue. Think about this. It's been a long time since God was kicked out of the schools in America. Been a long time since Roe versus Wade unleashed a Holocaust like the world has never seen before. It's unequal. Hitler pairs in comparison to that decision. Gays came out of the closet and into the Congress. Been a long time. Been a long time. God loves them. He doesn't want to judge them. He's waiting. He's long-suffering. He's sending warning after warning after warning. But he is holy and he is righteous, and he will eventually have to pass judgment. So he's unwilling to judge. It comes unexpected. The judgment of God is unexpected. Proverbs 6:12, a naughty person, a wicked man walketh with froward mouth. He winketh his eyes. He speaketh with his feet. He teacheth with his fingers. Frowardness is in his heart. He deviseth mischief continuously. He soweth discord. Therefore shall his calamity come suddenly suddenly shall he be broken and without remedy. He that being often reproved and hardeneth his neck shall suddenly be destroyed, and that without remedy. Lulled into a false sense of security. A rich farmer said, I'll eat and drink and be married in Luke chapter 12. And God said, thou fool, this night shall thy soul be required of thee. Ananias and Sapphira crossed the line and were suddenly, instantly destroyed. Unspeakable. Unspeakable. It's unexpected. It's unwilling. It's unspeakable. Matthew 24 and 21. For then shall be great tribulation such as was not since the beginning of the world to this time, nor shall ever be. Eye hath not seen. Words cannot describe. It is unspeakable. Unspeakable, the wrath that is coming. And then lastly, it's unnecessary. It's absolutely unnecessary. You don't have to go through those things. Jesus died so that you wouldn't have to go through those things.
Right.
Vietnam, our men fought hard and they fought valiantly and they fought proudly to take a hill just so that the government could give it away. Mm-hmm. Give it back to them. Unnecessary death and destruction for nothing. We could have just said, well, just keep it. Don't make us fight for it and give it back to them the next day and then tell us the next day to fight for it again. Don't die unnecessary death by rejecting Christ. Don't proclaim his death to have been unnecessary. You don't want to be here when God's bowls of wrath are poured out. And the great news is, you don't have to be.
Amen.
You don't have to be. But apart from Christ, you will be. Mm-hmm. Look at verse number 10. And the fifth angel poured out his vial upon the seal, upon the seat of the beast, and his kingdom was full of darkness, and they gnawed their tongues for pain. My. A plague of supernatural darkness. Supernatural darkness, just like in Moses' time in Egypt. Remember that? When he sent the darkness to cover all of Egypt, and it drove men crazy. It's darkness so thick you can feel it. So heavy. It won't be worldwide, according to the Bible. It'll be on the seat of the Antichrist, of the beast, wherever his headquarters is, whether it be in Jerusalem or Rome. But that's where it will take place. So I believe it's God's way of saying to the world, you could have followed the light, but you chose to follow the darkness. You could have had the bright morning star, but you've chosen the prince of darkness. God is not mocked. In verse number 12, I'll hurry. And the sixth angel poured out his vial upon the great river Euphrates, and the water thereof was dried up, that the way of the kings of the east might be prepared. Here it comes. Here it comes. Why the river Euphrates? Why a plague? The prominence of the river Euphrates in the Bible is absolutely extraordinary. It's mentioned in Genesis, and it's mentioned in the Revelation, and it's mentioned 25 times throughout the Word of God in between. It is extremely, extremely important. It's the approximate location of the Garden of Eden, the Bible scholars say. And here is where the battle of Armageddon will be. And it's kind of from the cradle to the grave. The same place. What once was paradise will be utter hell unleashed. It's in modern day Iraq, Iran, and Syria. Or ancient Babylon is what that is. Israel is a nation that is often are most often mentioned in the Bible. But secondly, and a very close second, is a rat, using different names. It's not the name used in the Bible, but this, the names used in the Bible are Babylon, land of Shinar, and Mesopotamia. The word Mesopotamia means between the two rivers, more exactly between the Tigris and Euphrates rivers. I've seen them both. The name Iraq means country with deep roots. It has indeed very, very deep roots. It's a very significant nation in the Bible. Here's why. Eden was in Iraq, Genesis 2 and 10. Adam and Eve were created in Iraq in Genesis 2, 7 and 8. Satan made his first record of recorded appearance in Iraq, Genesis 3. Nimrod established Babylon, and the Tower of Babel was built in Iraq, Genesis 10 and 11. The confusion of the languages took place in Iraq, Genesis 11. Abraham came from a city in Iraq, Genesis 11, confirmed by Acts chapter 7. Isaac's bride came from Iraq, according to Genesis chapter 24. Jacob spent 20 years in Iraq, according to Genesis 27. The first world empire, the Persian Empire, was in Iraq, according to Daniel 1 and 2, and Daniel 2. The greatest revival in history was in a city in Iraq. Did you know this? Nineveh. You know what Nineveh is? Mosul. The city of Mosul in Iraq, the third largest city in Iraq. It's still there today. According to Jonah chapter 3, the events of the book of Esther took place in Iraq. The book of Nahum was a prophecy against the city of Iraq. The book of Revelation has prophecies against Babylon, which is the old name for the nation of Iraq, Revelation 17 and 18. The sixth bowl, the waters of the Euphrates River are dried up. That's a river that's 1,800 miles long, over a half a mile wide, and 30 feet deep in most of it. Amen. It's going to be dried up in a hurry, probably from all this intense heat. Amen. But it's dried up for a specific reason. Amen. For the kings of the east. For the kings of the east. Almost all Bible scholars, not all, but almost all, agree that this is a reference to an Asian coalition that will be led by none other than Red China. This is a full-scale invasion of the West coming out of the East, unprecedented in the history of the world. The Euphrates has been kind of like an invisible line or a force field almost barrier to stop this. But think about this, the Euphrates River is the far eastern border of the land that God promised to Israel and to Abraham. The far eastern border that God keeps his promises, but here in the tribulation, it's off. All bets are off. He's going to use everything. An army of 200 million soldiers will come from the east, mobilized to march upon Israel. And they'll bring with them the technology that they've stolen from us, that we've had delivered to them by traitors, spies, and espionage over the last 20, 25 years. I just threw that in. That's free. It won't cost you nothing. Make no mistake, those that have betrayed us should be brought to justice and should pay with their lives. However, the strengthening of China is prophecy being fulfilled. An Asian coalition. China may lead the way, but listen, they're not the only ones. There's the Arab-African Confederacy that Daniel 11 talks about. That's the kings of the south. There's the Russian in Ezekiel 38 and 39, Gog and Magog, that Daniel called the kings of the north. Amen. The United States of Europe, which is the revived Roman Empire in the Bible, 10 toes of Daniel's statue. Israel's definitely a part of the end times and of the battle of Armageddon. And conservative estimates say that there will be at the very least 300 million soldiers marching against Israel. And probably more. No wonder the Bible says the blood will flow for 200 miles, as deep as the bridle of a horse, and it'll take 7 years to bury the dead. Seven months, to bury the dead. Amen. Look at verse 14. For they are the spirits of devils working miracles which go forth unto the kings of the earth and of the whole world to gather them to the battle of that great day of God Almighty. Amen. This nation, or this world, is absolutely fascinated with miracles. Miracle hungry. I mean, working, we're obsessed with supernatural healings and tongues and New Age mysticism, the occult, television shows about angels and UFOs. Area 51, the people of our world are being set up. The pump is being primed. Because when they see these people do these great signs and these wonders and these false miracles and all of these things, they're going to fall for it, hook, line, and sinker. Never, never weighing it against the word of God, Brother Philip, to see, trying the spirits to see if they be of God. Have an insatiable appetite for the miracles, so unholy trinity will be viewed as miracle-working gods. In the middle of all of this, we have this warning in verse 15. Behold, I come as a thief. Blessed is he that watcheth and keepeth his garments, lest he walk naked and they see his shame. That's Jesus talking. That's Jesus talking. In the middle of all of this, he says, behold, I come as a thief. Blessed is he that watcheth and keepeth his garments, lest he walk naked and they see his shame. Verse number 17, and the seventh angel poured out his vial into the air. Oh, this is the culmination of it all. And there came a great voice out of the temple of heaven from the throne saying, it is done. What did Jesus cry out from the cross, Brother Doug? It is finished. When he pours out this vial upon the air, that is the very throne room of Satan himself. He is the prince of the air. Amen. That's what he says. And he takes this vial and pours it out into the air. It destroys the last trace of Satan's abiding place. Ephesians 2 and 2, the prince of the power of the air. And this plague destroys every single nook and cranny of Satan's hiding place. God is not mocked. It was never his. It belonged to God. God created the air, amen. He created it all for himself. Air is the preferred method of war today. Think about it. We pelted Iraq from hundreds of miles away with missiles from ships through the air. JDAM bombs from dropped from miles and miles in the air and could shoot them through a window, amen. All of those things. And here it is. What else in the natural realm could cause an earthquake like this? Look at verse number 18, and I'll be finished, okay? And that came with me, just for a few more
minutes. Richard.
And there were voices and thunderings and lightnings, and there was a great earthquake, such as what was not since men were upon the earth, so mighty an earthquake and so great. And the great city was divided into three parts, and the cities of the nations fell, and great Babylon came in remembrance before God to give unto her the cup of the wine of the fierceness of his wrath. And every island fled away, and the mountains were not found. And there fell upon men a great hail out of heaven, every stone the weight of a talent. And that's about 140-something pounds, amen. And men blasphemed God, and because of the plague of the hail, for the plague thereof was exceeding great. Imagine this. Islands are going to disappear.
Yeah.
Hawaii will be gone. Long Island will be gone. All of the islands of the South Pacific will be gone. Great mountains will disappear. The Himalayas will be gone. The Rockies will be gone. Our mountains will be gone. They will be the earthquake will be so severe. It says that there will not be one wall left standing built by the hand of man. Not one will be left standing. It will be flattened. When God says, I'm going to utterly destroy, you need to understand he means what he says. These things will happen in a very, very short period of time. The absolute decimation of the world. And then God himself, Jesus, is going to throw his leg across his white stallion. And he's going to fix his crown on his head. Amen. Of every nation. And he's going to say, saddle up, boys. It's time to go. And the thunderings from the hooves of the millions upon millions of the redeemed, riding on their white horses in their white apparel, amen, following the Lord Jesus Christ back to this earth in power and great glory. And the Bible says he's going to step one foot on the sea and one foot on the land. Amen. Amen. And that old Antichrist, amen, is going to be just dissolved, I believe, from his throne because of the power of his glory and the light, the brightness of his coming. My. I don't know about you. That gives me a sickness in my stomach. To understand and know these things. To understand and know that these things are going to come to real people. Not just words on a page in a book. This is real. And those who reject Christ Jesus, those who take the mark of the beast will suffer these things. Whoever you know is lost, pray that God somehow, some way, can draw them to himself. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you and we praise you for your word. We thank you, Lord. We love you. Your mercy, for your long suffering. We pray tonight, God, for those that don't know you. We pray tonight, God, for those that have rejected the teachings of Christ, have rejected your word, have rejected you. We pray tonight, God, that somehow, some way, we could love them to you. We could just some way, somehow present the gospel in a way that they would be receptive. God, I pray you just prepare hearts, prepare minds. You make the way. Apart from you, we can't do anything. But God, with you, we can do anything, everything. And so, God, we're going to trust you in that. We're going to praise you. We're going to thank you for the victories that you'll give and for the souls that you'll bring our way. In Jesus' name, for his sake, we ask and pray these things. Amen. Amen. Thank you for your kindness.